temptation and even the things that are contrary to the doctrine of eternal security, because there are people and pastors, even churches, who teach us that a believer can lose their salvation, and that a believer can fall away from being saved to the point of not believing anymore, thereby, because of that, losing the salvation that they have acquired by repenting of their sins and receiving or accepting the Lord Jesus Christ as their Savior. So this is what we're going to study. But as a text, let us stand up and open our Bibles in Romans chapter 8, verses 28 and 29. So we will read this in unison. Are you there, amen? Okay, so let us read. Go. And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to His purpose, for whom He did foreknow, He also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of His Son, that He might be the firstborn among many brethren. Father, we thank You, Lord, for the verses that we have read. Please, Lord, speak to us as we study this all-important topic in the Bible about eternal security. Help us, Lord, that we can be that we can have peace, knowing that the security You have given to us is something that You are holding, and it is absolutely secured, O God. Help us, Lord, not to be deceived by teachings that are going on, even using Your word in order to disprove that the salvation that You have given us is something that we can build upon. So I pray, Lord, that You will give us illumination, even though this is a topic that we have maybe discussed for so many times. I just pray, Lord, that it will deepen our understanding of the eternal security of our salvation. We thank You, Lord. May You be glorified in our midst. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. So I'm not going to discuss about predestination, but I'm just going to use it as a springboard that the Lord is giving us an assurance that once we are saved, once we are foreknown by God, then there is a destiny that all saved people or all those who receive the Lord Jesus Christ will be arriving at in their lives, or even throughout all eternity. So it is a word of assurance, because it is something that has been predetermined by God regarding those people who will go the way that God wanted them to go, especially when it comes to salvation. Now, the thing is that in the Bible there are many truths that are revealed from God to us, and some of these are hard to understand. Not everything written in the Bible is easy to understand. Some of them are actually hard, and we're going to have a hard time understanding them if we will not rely on the Holy Spirit, and if we're not going to diligently study the Word of God. 2 Peter 3:16, please. This is what the Bible says about this. 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 16. As also in all these epistles, speaking in them of these things, in which are some things hard to be understood. So do not be discouraged that whenever you read the Bible, there are things that you are having a hard time understanding. Because even the Bible says that there are some things hard to be understood. But be encouraged, because the Bible did not say many things are hard to be understood, but only some. And those things definitely will need more diligence, more rightly dividing the word of truth, and more reliance on the Holy Spirit, so that we can understand. Because the Bible says, which they that are unlearned and unstable rest. And sometimes the problem is this. Some people, if they do not understand the word of God, will interpret it privately. And that is the reason why there are so many erroneous doctrine or teachings that are going on in our time. Because of their instability, they rest. Meaning to say, they give a different meaning or interpretation or even try to adapt the Word of God to their own peculiar teaching or their biases. That is the reason why when a pastor believes that this will help them, he's going to use pragmatism and not the truth of the Word of God by teaching these things, looking and emphasizing on the result rather than the truth that the Word of God is teaching. And then, of course, there are those that are unlearned, not saying that they are completely ignorant, but we already know that we lack learning, we lack wisdom, but we refrain from asking God. Wherein we are encouraged in James that if any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God. Because God will give us wisdom liberally and he will not upbraid anything. Meaning to say, to those people who want to learn and are diligent in pursuing this kind of learning, God will give them an open door so that they can learn as much as they want to learn with the help and by the help of the Holy Spirit. And then it says that as they do also other scriptures unto their own destruction. You see, it is very dangerous to lean upon your own understanding when it comes to Bible interpretation, because whatever you interpreted by yourself, you will teach, and it will result into your own destruction, and those people that may hear you, will listen to you, or simply trusting that you will give them the understanding that they need because they themselves are too lazy to study the Word of God. So there is a very great responsibility in standing behind the pulpit. It is not just, you know, proclaiming, it is not just giving your oration, it is not just giving your speech, but it is becoming a mouthpiece of the Lord Jesus Christ. And as such, we should be very, very careful regarding the things that we are going to say, because they must always jive with what the Lord Jesus Christ wants his people or his children to know. So there are things that are hard to understand, and not only that, but also in the Bible there are things that we will only understand when we get to heaven. We cannot understand them here. Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 13 verse number 12. For now we see through a glass darkly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then shall I know even as also I am known. So face to face, meaning to say when we are facing God, when we are in heaven, that's the time that there are things that we will know there and only there. The Bible says secret things belongs to God. There are things that are not revealed, and there are things that even though they are revealed, we do not have the ability and capability to understand them all today, because we are in a limited mind, state of mind. Even science actually say that a very intelligent or a genius person can only use about 10% of his mental capacity. So meaning to say, the rest will be revealed to us and we will know them maybe at the same time when we are already in heaven. So that's the reason why many people are frustrated when there are things that they cannot understand, and when there are things that they are having a hard time understanding whenever they read the Word of God. And because of that, they are going to fall into many erroneous teaching and many erroneous interpretation. And one such item is what we call, can a believer ever be lost? Can a believer fall away to the point that this believer is going to lose his salvation? So this is what we're going to look at today, and look at several verses and several reasons why many people are teaching against assurance of salvation and why they believe that we can lose our salvation, and then later on we will end up on reasons why we cannot lose our salvation from the Word of God. Now, notice the word believer. When we say believer, this is a person who trusted on the Lord Jesus Christ. Let us go to Romans chapter 10, verse 9. Romans chapter 10 and verse number 9. That if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and shalt believe in thine heart that God that raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. So a believer is a person who confess the Lord Jesus Christ with his mouth, and it is a person who believes in his heart. And because of that confession and because of that belief, of course, the things that are included, repentance and faith, the Bible says or proclaim that person is saved. So when you say believer, it is the same as a saved person. A believer is saved. Amen. A biblical believer in biblical salvation is biblically saved, because even the devil believes, but they are not saved. Even unbelievers have a certain degree of belief, but they are not saved. The belief that will save us is the belief on the finished work of the Lord Jesus Christ on the cross of Calvary. So a believer is not only saved, but a believer is also described in the Bible as a person who was regenerated or was born again. In John chapter 3, verse 3 and 7. This is what the Bible says. Jesus answered and said unto him, verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. And verse number 7, marvel not that I said unto thee, ye must be born again. So he is a believer. A believer is a person who believes, and a believer is a person who was born again. Meaning to say, a person who experienced the second birth. A person who believes in the Lord Jesus Christ, and he was born from above. He was birthed spiritually by God. Look at John chapter 1, verse number 12. But as many as receive him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. So when you receive the Lord Jesus Christ, he has given you the power or the authority, or he made you a child or a son of God. Meaning to say, those that believe on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, because there is no other name given under heaven whereby we might be saved, but only the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. So a believer is saved. A believer is a person who was born again. A believer is a person who received the Lord Jesus Christ. And a believer is washed by the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. 1 John 1:7. 1 John 1:7. It says, but if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanseth us from all sin. So we were washed by the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. For without the shedding of the blood, there is no remission of sin. There must be a person who should die for us vicariously so that we can receive the promised salvation that God has given to those who will believe on the name of his only begotten Son. So in effect, the Lord Jesus Christ died for us. The Bible says, with his stripes, we are healed. So yung ginawa niya ang epekto sa atin. Hindi naman kailangan maligtas ng Panginoon dahil hindi naman siya makasalanan at hindi siya papunta sa impyerno. But he has the ability, the capacity to pay for our sins. And some people may object, if the Lord Jesus Christ paid for our sins, which is eternal death, so he must die eternally. No, because God is eternal. Whatever God doeth, it shall be forever. So when he died forever, but then he is alive and he will be alive forever. Kaya hindi niya kailangan mamatay forever at manatiling patay forever without any other capacity or capability because he is God and not man. Hindi tulad natin. Pag namatay tayo, napunta tayo sa impyerno, yun na lang, wala na iba. Tao kasi tayo eh. Limited tayo. Hindi tayo all present. Hindi tayo ganun. Pero ang Diyos may ibang kakayahan na hindi abot ng ating kakayahan. So nung mamatay siya, binayaran niya yung eternal debt, yung ginawa niya is for eternity. Kaya bayad na yon. Pero hindi siya mananatiling patay kasi Diyos siya at tapos na yung ginawa niya. Kaya sabi ng Panginoon, it is finished, completed. It has been paid yung ating mga kasalanan. So kaya ito na ngayon tayo, ligtas. Amen? We are now saved. We have an assurance that whenever we die, we will go to heaven and that is for sure. But then again, the devil is on the warpath and he will not want any Christian to have a peace of mind because a Christian who is peaceful is going to be an effective Christian. But a Christian who is doubtful or unstable is something that God will not be able to use effectively in whatever the Lord wanted that Christian to accomplish in his life. Hence, the different teachings regarding eternal security, that even though you are saved, but you can still lose that salvation, so we have to be careful on how we live. Now, we need to understand that God wants us to be sure of our salvation. Why? That's why He saved us. If you want to help a person, you want to be sure that the person is helped. Simple as that. If you want to help that person to be educated, you want to be sure that that person is going to be an educated person, because otherwise what you have done will be wasted. And the Bible is very clear that whatsoever God will do is not going to be in vain. There is always a result, because the Lord said it will accomplish the things where the Lord has sent or have done something in the life of a person. So we need to understand that God wants me to be assured of my salvation, and God wanted you to be assured of your salvation, so that if we can settle this matter by the grace of God, then we can go on giving or being a channel of salvation and giving assurance of salvation to those people who will hear the gospel and believe the Lord Jesus Christ as their Savior. So, what happens? What transpired? Why there are so many teaching that is contrary to assurance of salvation? So, as I have told you a while ago, because people lean unto their own understanding and people are not rightly dividing the word of truth. Let me give you several reasons why this kind of teaching surfaced in our Christian history. Number one, they believe that us people, we are without strength, that we are weak. And because we are weak, we fail. And because we fail, we wonder that if something happens, if we are still safe, or if we can endure unto the end of our lives in order to secure our salvation. They believe, like what Paul told the Galatians in chapter 3, that they are full because they started with the Spirit and they are now trying to continually be saved by the flesh. So, it is like this. They said that yes, when we receive the Lord Jesus Christ, we are forgiven, we're justified, we are saved. But now that we are saved, we need to keep our salvation. And because we are weak, then we will not be able to keep our salvation every time. There will be times that we can fall. There will be times that we can not be able to hold on to the salvation that was given to us by God. therefore, we cannot be sure until we are dead if we are really saved or not. Kaya wala rin katiyakan. Wala rin makapagsasabi. Kaya madalas natin marinig, ay Diyos ang nakakaalam kung ligtas ka o hindi. Which, in one sense, totoo naman. In one sense, totoo na Diyos ang nakakaalam kung ligtas tayo o hindi. Pero sabi ko, ang word of God ba, salita ng Diyos? Oo. So kung Diyos ang nakakaalam, pwede niya ipaalam sa atin sa kanyang salita kung ligtas tayo o hindi. And therefore, we can be assured from the word of God if we are really saved by reading the word of God and understanding the word of God. So that is why this teaching came about. Secondly, they said that there are those Christians who profess salvation, but now they have nothing to do with Christ anymore. So these people have lost their salvation because they have been at one time active in the church, even a member of the choir, or even a pastor. But now, they are an atheist and they do not believe in God. So therefore, a Christian can apostatize to the point of losing his faith and thereby losing his salvation. Kasi nga naman, ang classic example nila dyan si Judas, na apostol yan ng Panginoon. At sasabihin nila, hindi ba ang Diyos hindi nagkakamali sa pagpili? Sino bang pumili kay Judas? Hindi ba si Kristo? Ay di hindi nagkamali si Kristo. So, si Judas talaga ligtas. Kaya lang, matapos siyang piliin, matapos niyang maligtas, eh, nagkaroon siya ng ibang pananampalataya na wala yung pananampalataya niya sa Panginoon at napunta sa pera, to the point that he even sold the Lord Jesus Christ and have chosen money than the Savior. Therefore, he died and went to his own place losing his salvation. Nakatulad na nangyayari sa iba. Sabihin pa nila, di nyo ba napapansin dati? Asan na yung mga dati? Ngayon, wala na sila. At kahit anong gawin mo, hindi na manunumbalik. So kasi, nawala na yung kanilang kaligtasan. So that is how they interpret that. Number three, some scriptures seem to teach that we can lose our salvation. May mga verses sa Bible na para bagang nagtuturo. Ulitin ko ha, seemingly, para bagang, hindi pangil ha, bagang, nagtuturo that we can lose our salvation. One example is Matthew chapter 24 verse 13 na ginagamit ng karamihan ng mga charismatic din ito. Sabi nila, but he that shall endure at saka yung mga cults unto the end, the same shall be saved. So they will tell you, nobody can know for sure because we need to wait until the end. And the end can only mean two things, the end of your life or the end of this world as we know it at the second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. So, until you reach the end, you have no right to say that you are saved and you have no right to tell people that they are saved because you are not sure. Maybe in the end, you will commit sin. That's why there are people when you ask them, saved ka na ba? At sure ka bang ang kaligtasan mo mananatili? Ay, kung hindi na ako magkakasala, kung hindi na ako magkakamali, o kung hindi na ako makagagawa ng sin unto death or unpardonable sin. So, hindi pa rin ako sure. Kaya nga, nag-iingat ako sa aking pamumuhay para matiyak ko na talagang ako'y sa langit pupunta kapag ka ako ay namatay. Because of Matthew chapter 24 verse 13. 1 Corinthians 9:27, sabi niya, si Paul nga, hindi niya tiyak na siya'y ligtas because of this verse. But I keep under my body and bring it into subjection, lest that by any means, when I have preached to others, I myself should be a cast away. Ibig sabihin ng cast away, sa Tagalog ay itinakwil. So, papaanong ligtas yung itinakwil? Tinakwil nga eh. So, ibig sabihin, hindi ka nakabilang doon sa sa kaligtasan na ibinigay o ginawa ng ating Panginoon. And the one who is talking about this is none other than the Apostle Paul. Kaya maliwanag kanila na ang kaligtasan ay hindi sure. Kailangan natin ikip. Ayun, yung kaligtasan na yun. Kailangan natin disiplinahin yung ating sarili. Kailangan tayong subjected sa mga kagustuhan ng Panginoon para manatili yung ating kaligtasan. And then John chapter 15. Ito, classic ito. Paborito ito ng karamihan. Verse number 6. At pag ikinontext mo, of course. If a man abide not in me, he is cast forth as a branch and is withered, and men gather them and cast them into the fire and they are burned. O, kita mo na? Kung hindi ka rin lang mananatili sa Panginoon, ikaw ay kakasport bilang branch at ikaw ay malalanta at iipunin ka ng mga tao at itatapong ka sa apoy at ikaw ay masusunog. Impyerno yan, branch na yan. Nakadikit na dati kay Kristo yan, pero nalanta. Inalis, itinapon sa apoy at sinunog. Kaya huwag mo sasabihin na porkit nakadikit ka sa Panginoon, malakas ka. Pwede ka pang mabali. Dudugtong ang panilayan. Ang Israel nga, pinutol bilang branch. Hindi ba? Tayo pa kaya? Ayan. Yan yung kanilang ituturo. Kumbinsido na ba kayo na nawawalang kaligtasan? O, kulang pa. Dali ha. Nadagdagan ko pa ha, para maging sure na tayo na talagang hindi tayo save. Ayan. Kasi baka ito maging result ng turo eh. Pastor, natutunan ko po na hindi pala talaga ako. Tiyak na ligtas. Kaya magalala, sasagutin natin ito ha. Galatians 5:4. Galatians chapter 5 verse number 4. Christ is become of no effect unto you. Whosoever of you are justified by the law, ye are fallen from grace. O pwede ka palang mahulog sa grace. From grace, di ba? So, ang kaligtasan, grace, bumalik ka sa pagsunod ng law, you are fallen from grace. So, hindi ka na, for by grace are you saved through faith. Dahil nagtiwala ka na sa law. At yung justification mo ay iyon ang ibinase sa law, hindi sa grace ng Panginoon. Therefore, you now believe that you are justified by your works and not by the grace of God anymore. So you can reach a state of mind that you can repent of your repentance. Nagbago isip ko, repentance. Nagbago ulit ang isip ko, re-repentance. Ayan. So pagka nagkaroon ka ng re-repentance, hindi ka na say, bumalik ka na dun sa dati mong kalagayan. And then of course, itong pinakamahirap, Hebrews 6 at saka 10. Bible school, ito yung pinag-aawayan, pinagbubugbugan talaga regarding assurance. No, Hebrews 6, 4 to 6 muna. Yan, sabi, for it is impossible for those who were once enlightened and obtasted of the heavenly gift and were made partakers of the Holy Ghost and obtasted the good word of God and the powers of the word to come, if they shall fall away, to renew them again unto repentance. Ayon. So, na-enlighten ka na. Lahat na, naranasan mo. Tapos nag-fall away ka. Hindi ka na makapagsisisi. O, hindi ka na pwedeng, impossible na to renew them unto repentance, seeing they crucify to themselves the Son of God afresh and put Him to an open shame. So, pag ikaw ay partaker ka na ng ano, Holy Spirit, enlightened ka na, naalaman mo na lahat ng tama, naintindihan mo na, eh nag-fall away ka. Hindi ka na uli makakapanumbalik. So, nawala na yung kaligtasan mo forever. Wala na, forever na. Kasi imposible ka nang manumbalik na i-renew ka sa repentance. So, hindi na mangyayari yun. And then, 10, 26 to 29, mas pinatindi pa nito. For if we sin willfully, ayan. Na we, kanya kasama yung author. Ay, yung author, ligtas. Ay, di ba? And then, ang ginawa nating kasalanan, sinasadya. Kaya nag-iisip ako ng kasalanan di sinasadya eh. Parang medyo, kung meron man, mangilan-ngilan o mahirap. Kasi, halimbawa, hindi ka atin na linggo, most probably, sinadya mo yun eh. Di ba? Ay, hindi ko sinasadya, hindi ako naka-attend. Parang gano'n, di ba? Yung ano, ay, hindi ko sinasadya, hindi ako nakapag-offering. Parang gano'n, sinasadya mo yun eh. Mga ano yung premeditated actions yan eh. Pero sabi rito, for if we sin willfully, after that we have received the knowledge of the truth. Nalaman mo na yung katotohanan. There remaineth no more sacrifice for sins. Disqualified na tayo sa kaligtasan. But a certain fearful looking for of judgment and fiery indignation which shall devour the adversaries. Kaya pagka nag-fall away ka, apoy naghihintay sa'yo. He that despised Moses' law died without mercy under two or three witnesses. Oh, how much more? Ah, hindi lang yung noon, stone to death eh. How much more sorer punishment suppose ye shall he be thought worthy who hath trodden underfoot the Son of God and hath counted the blood of the covenant wherewith he was sanctified an unholy thing and hath done despite unto the spirit of grace. So ito yung mga dahilan kung bakit ang kaligtasan daw ay nawawala. Bakit hindi tayo pwedeng maging sure ng ating salvation? Ngayon, I'm not going to discuss this in detail because it will take so much time to study them in detail. But they will be categorized and we will look at the reason why they cannot be used or accepted as verses seemingly teaching that a saved person can lose his salvation. So that is what we're going to do. So in passing lang, yung mababaw na pag-aaral lang but sufficient in order for us to understand. Kasi minsan, yung malalim na pag-aaral, nakakagulo. Minsan, pag masyado mo nilaliman at hindi naman natin totally naintindihan pa o hindi ka pa handa, malulunod ka. So siguro, yung basic minsan, yun lang talaga ang kailangan natin so that we can really understand. Pero before we go there, isa pa nilang complaint is that it is very dangerous to teach eternal security because it will lead into a life of lasciviousness. Meaning to say, well, ligtas na pala ako eh. Eh, gagawin ko na gusto kong gawin. Hindi naman pala nawawala ang kaligtasan ko. So, kahit ako pumatay, kahit ako mag-rape, kahit ako mag-nakaw, kahit ako magsinungaling, kahit ako makipagbasa ng ulo, kahit hindi ako umattend ng church, kahit hindi ako magbasa ng Bible, kahit hindi ako manalangin, save na ako eh. So, magagawa ko na ang gusto kong gawin. Praise God. Ay, di ba? Oh, biro mo, save ka na. Kahit ano pa gawin mo, mananatili kang ligtas. E di, para kang ano, naging, para kasi James Bond, license to kill. Wala kang pananagutan kahit makapatay ka pa ng tao. So, ganun yung sabi ng iba, kaya huwag niyong ituturo yan. Hindi totoo yan kasi na-prostrate dyan ang grace of God. Nagkakaroon tayo ng liberty that will be unrestrained. That even God cannot do anything about it because He was in the first place the author of our eternal security. Therefore, He cannot deny His word and He cannot deny Himself. He has no choice but to bring us to heaven no matter what because He already saved us. Yun yung mga reason why they believe that we can lose our salvation. So how are we going to answer this? Very simple answer is that doon sa unang objection that we are weak, that we cannot keep our salvation, the very simple explanation is that we are not the ones keeping our salvation. It is being kept by God. John chapter 10, verses 27 to 29. Dito pa lang maliwanag na eh, na hindi na dapat pagtalunan pa. My sheep hear my voice and I know them and they follow me. And I give unto them eternal life. So we were given eternal life. And they shall never perish. Never, no, not under any circumstance, under any time? Never. Pag naliligaw ka, sinabi sa'yo, never kitang magugustuhan, maghanap ka na ng iba. Kasi kung honest yung tao, hindi ka na niya magugustuhan. Yun yung never. No, never. Never enough. Never. Never. Wala na talaga. They shall never perish, neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. Notice, we are in the hand of the Lord Jesus Christ. Sino humahawak sa atin? Siya. Hindi tayo ang ano yan? Ah? Oo nga. In English ko, tapos tatagalogin ko. Hindi, not us. That is it is not us, it is He. Not us, that is holding our salvation. Because the Bible says, neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. Nobody, but nobody can pluck us away from the hands of God. He, of Jesus. Jesus is the one holding our salvation. We are not holding our salvation. Because if we are the ones holding our salvation, we will definitely lose it. Why? Because we cannot keep on living the Christian life in a perfect way. There will be times that we will stumble, and there will be times that we will fall, and therefore, during those times, our salvation will slip away from us. But because Jesus is the one holding us and holding our salvation, therefore, we cannot be lost anymore. Because the security that Jesus is providing is an airtight security. Not only that, look at verse number 29. My Father, ayan, which gave them me, is greater than all. And no man is able to pluck them out of my Father's hand. So our salvation is being held not only by God the Son, but God the Father also. And for good measure, we are sealed with a promise by the Holy Spirit. So our salvation is a triple layer security that even Satan will not be able to hack into the system para maglagay ng virus to destroy our salvation. So we are in the hands of God. That's why we cannot lose what we do not have. No, what we do not keep, we have it pala. We cannot lose what we do not keep. Para bang in boxing, if you are fighting in the ring, and if you are being pummeled, and there is really no match, your manager will throw the towel as a sign that the match is over, that you're giving up. So, what, pastor, if we do that? No, we cannot do it because we are the fighter. We are not holding the towel. So we cannot throw it. The one who's holding the towel is our manager. And if Jesus Christ is the one holding the towel, He prepared us in order for us to have victory. Therefore, He will never throw in the towel. So therefore, our salvation is secured. Not only that, look at 1 Peter 1:5 to make things clearer. Who are kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. Who is keeping us? The power of God. Oh, see? Who can thwart the power of God? Is there a person in the whole universe that can overpower God? Wala. That's why we are secured, because He is the one keeping our salvation through His power, and it's going to be revealed in the last time, meaning to say it's secured until the last time. And He will be kept by His power. Not only that, but Jude 24, this is very clear. baka ako eh, may spice eh. I know, spice girls eh. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling. No, see? Hindi nga tayo magpo-fall eh. Why? Because him, the Lord Jesus Christ, is able, he is capable, he has the power to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. So he has the ability, the willingness, the capability to not allow us to fall and to present us perfect. Oh, see? Hindi nga pinag-uusapan yung dahil nagkasala ka, nag-fall ka. Perfect, faultless. Yung pagpapresent na gagawin niya sa atin. In the presence of His glory with exceeding joy. Ito'y kinonfirm ni Apostle Paul emphatically dito sa 2 Timothy 1:12. Ano masabi niya? For the which cause I also suffer these things. Nevertheless, I am not ashamed, for I know whom I have believed, and I am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I have committed unto him against that day. Oh, sino raw ang nagkikip? Panginoon. Ano raw si Paul? Persuaded. Kilala ko yung pinanampalatayanan ko. Alam kong kaya niya na ingatan yung pinagkatiwala ko sa kanya. Alin? Yung kaligtasan natin. Yung pananampalataya natin. Hanggang kailan? Against that day. Ano yung day? The day that we die or the day that we face the Lord Jesus Christ. So it is very clear that our salvation cannot be lost. So hindi pinag-uusapan yung enduring unto the end. Yung enduring unto the end, sa tribulation yun, na pinag-uusapan daw, huwag kang mamatay hanggang matapos. Ang end, anong end? Yung dispensation of tribulation. Hindi dispensation of the grace of God. Hindi dispensation of church age, but the dispensation of tribulation. If you will be alive until then you will be saved. Both nationally as a member of the Commonwealth of Israel and spiritually because you have kept your faith. Until that end, so you will enter millennium in your physical body. Pero pag namatay ka, glorified body. Kaya lang, ang Jews, during the time of tribulation, will be in a survival mode through hiding. Tandaan nyo ha, walang fighting. They're not going to fight the Antichrist. Eh, hindi nyo ba napansin? If you're going to read the tribulation period, the Christians are not going to fight the Antichrist except for the two witnesses. The 144,000 will only preach the word of God, but they're not going to raise arms against the Antichrist. And for that matter, the 144,000 will all be martyred during the tribulation period. All of them will die. Why do they have to preach the gospel? Because the Jews as well as the nations that will be left behind must understand the word of God for their salvation. So, yung Matthew 24:13 is very clearly under the tribulation period and those who will endure unto the end of what? That period shall be saved. Both physically, they will not die because those who will believe will be killed on the spot. But they have survived, so they are saved physically and they will enter the millennium, they are saved spiritually. But it does not apply to us that we are going to keep doing those things that will prove that we are saved or will keep doing things so that we will remain saved until the end of life. That is the wrong interpretation of that. What is clear is that we are not keeping our salvation. It is God who is keeping our salvation. So there is nothing that we can do in order to make ourselves saved. But when we are saved, we are eternally secured. Yun po yung sinasabi ng Bible. So, number two, those Christians who seem to have fallen away, the question is this, were they truly saved in the first place? Were they truly saved? Because there are people who can act according to their emotions. And most of the time, our emotions are unreliable. And they cannot be trusted because the Bible says, the heart of man is deceitful above all. And who can know it? That's what the Bible says. So it is not uncommon to see people who will come to the church and so emotionally attached. And because they are so emotionally attached or touched, they are going to be very enthusiastic in what they are doing. Parang ganito yan eh. Di ba sasabihin sa iyo ng tao, I love you? That's emotion. Pero pagkatapos, mamaya, may iba na namang sasabi ang I love you. At mamaya, meron na namang ibang sasabi ang I love you. At pamaya-maya, meron na namang ibang sasabi ang I love you. Pero nung sinabi niya I love you sa'yo, during that time, paniwalang-paniwala siya, talagang yun ang nararamdaman niya. Right? But emotions is not reliable, therefore cannot be the basis of our salvation or eternal security. Because nag-change ang ano? Emotion. Di ba? At hindi ito reliable. That is the reason why it is common to see people who are in the church very active, very enthusiastic. When the emotion fades away, they too will not be seen in the church anymore and will go back to what they have been doing before. That's why you cannot say that he actually lost his salvation, because the question is, was that person even saved in the first place? Now, there are those who are simply disobedient even though they are children of God. That they will, for a time, fall away, seem to fall away, but because you are saved, because you have the Holy Spirit will do His ministry in your life, that definitely you will be convicted even to the extreme that before you die, you are going to go back to your faith, which actually will remain your faith, but you have been deceived. An example of that is the prodigal son. He was a son, but he was a prodigal son. But he remained a son, but in a state of disobedience. But because of that, because he was a son, the Holy Spirit keeps on convicting him. So when he came to his wit's end, he was reminded that he has a father who treated his servants better than what he was being treated there. So he said, if I will come back and become a servant, I will be treated better than where I am now. Meaning to say, when you backslide, no matter what kind of life you may have, your life in being a Christian is far more better than the best life that an unbeliever can experience in his life. Kaya hindi comparable yung pagiging anak ng Diyos kesa sa hindi anak ng Diyos. So you will definitely come back. Because why? There is the ministry of the Holy Spirit in your life. And also we can see in Luke chapter 15, 11 to 24. This is also an example of two children in the life of a father in this passage. As he said, a certain man had two sons. And the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the portion of the goods. This is the prodigal son. And then we can see that later on in his life, he understood that it is better to be there. But look, there are people who may be in the church, faithful, and who keeps on doing what they should have done, but their heart is away from God. So there are two kinds of backsliders here. You understand? One is a physical backslider, and the other one is backslider in heart. You can be here, But you can still be a prodigal son or a backslider. That is why this study is also very important when it comes to the ministry of the Holy Spirit in our lives and the attitude of a truly child of God. Even though they will stumble and fall for a while, they will definitely come back because there is no perpetual backsliding in the life of a saved person. Before God will allow us to perpetually backslid, He's going to bring us home so that we're not going to continue shaming the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. So that is why it may just be a simple case of being disobedient but not actually losing salvation, or it is a very simple case of they're not saved in the first place. Na emotion lang yan. Parang sabi mo, parang ikaw, nakailang girlfriend ka na, yung bang unang girlfriend mo, hindi mo minahal. Di ba, tiwala kang mahal mo? Eh, ba't ngayon, iba na? O, emotion kasi. Ganun din yung mga nagpunta sa church, na naging active, akala nila naniniwala talaga sila, akala nila mahal nila ang Panginoon, akala nila mahal nila ang church. Eh, nung nagsawa, iba na. Di ba? So, ganun yan. Kasi, they base their salvation on how they feel. And it can be confirmed by the parable of the sower. Di ba? Maliwanag yun. Yung ibang tumanggap, agad-agad tinanggap, at talagang naging ano sila. Very active. Pero pamaya-maya, nung sumikat na yung araw, nainitan, wala na. O so may mga darating sa umpisa, uy, nakakatuwa ang fellowship dito. Okay yung mga tao, dito ako. Eh, may nakagalit na. Pareho lang pala yung mga yan. O, wala na. Bakit? Doon sa ano eh? Sa emotion tumingin. Hindi doon talaga sa katotohanan ng salita ng Diyos. That's the reason why our life is very important in proving our salvation. That is something that we cannot separate. The two are inseparable, ika nga. Now, we can see that in the Scripture never teaches that we can lose our salvation. Those examples, they either do not refer to true believers or they are referring to other areas of a believer's life and not salvation. Like for example, in 1 Corinthians 9:27, maliwanag dyan. Sabi ni Paul, but I keep under my body and bring it unto subjection, lest that by any means when I have preached to others, I myself should be a castaway. Paul is talking about his service to the Lord. Paul is talking about his ministry. That if he's not going to be diligent in ministering. Like for example, the Bible says that a steward, it is required in a steward that a man be found faithful. Why? Because if you're not faithful, then they will not believe your stewardship. Like for example, if you're a preacher and you do not practice what you preach, people will not listen to you anymore. This is what the Apostle Paul is talking about. That's why he said, when I have preached to others, I myself should be a castaway. Itakwil ako ng mga pinangangaralan ko. Parang sabi mo, huwag kayong magnakaw, binato mo. Sinalo nila. Eh kasi magnanakaw ka eh. Huwag kayong magnakaw, ibabato sa'yo. O isa lang binato mo, yung bumato sa'yo, libo-libo. They will not believe what you're saying. Because you are not diligent in your service and you are not truthful in serving the Lord. So this does not talk about salvation. How to clarify this? Let us look at the context. Taasan natin, tas ibaba na, tapusin natin ang chapter. I therefore so run, not as uncertainly, so fight I, not as one that beateth the air. It's not talking about salvation. It's talking about the Christian life. It is talking about serving the Lord. It is talking about preparing ourselves to be fitted for the Master's use. That is the point. Then tuloy natin kung meron pang titirang verse. Last verse na ba yan? Taas mo pa. Umpisa mo nga sa 21. 22. To the weak became I as weak that I might gain the weak. So, talking about salvation, talking about serving the Lord. I am made all things to all men that I might by all means save some. Talking about his serving, service of evangelism. And this I do for the gospel's sake, that I might be partaker thereof with you. Magkabunga ako sa inyo. Maging blessing ako sa inyo. Know ye not that they which run in a race run all, but one receiveth the prize. So run that ye may obtain. So kung ito'y kaligtasan, ba isa lang maliligtas? At labanan pa tayo. Kung sino pinakamagaling, siya ligtas. Yung hindi ligtas. And every man that striveth for the mastery is temperate. So talking about our attitude as a Christian, our discipline as a Christian. In all things, now they do it to obtain a corruptible crown, not salvation. So service ito, reward ito. But we, an incorruptible. I therefore so run, not as uncertainly, so fight I, not as one that beateth the air. Tapos sabi niya, but I keep under my body and bring it into subjection. Discipline my body. Lest that by any means, when I preach to others, I myself should be a cast away. So paano mo mawala ang kaligtasan? Hindi naman kaligtasan pinag-uusapan. Hindi ba? So yun yung point. Para silang, ang usap mat, ipinasok nila geography. So walang punto yung pinag-uusapan. Gusto lang kasi nakita lang nila yung word na cast away, inilagay na agad sa kaligtasan. O kita mo, pwede ka itakwil. So pag itinakwil ka, wala na. Aba hindi. Ko-context mo kasi the one that will explain the verse is the context. And the context is very clear that it is talking about service or Christian service, not about salvation. The same thing with John chapter 15. Let us first go to verse 1 because they use verse 6. I am the true vine and my Father is the husbandman. Every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away. And every branch that beareth fruit, he purgeth it that it may bring forth more fruit. Ano pinag-uusapan? Fruit bearing. Diba? So we're talking about serving. Because as we serve God, it will yield fruit. So if you will not serve, you're not going to be fruitful. And there is no such thing as that God says that if you are fruitful, then you're not saved anymore. So let's continue. Now ye are clean. See? Ye are clean. We're not talking about you being dirty. We're not talking about you being like the word. We're not talking about you as not forgiven. Ye are clean through the word which I have spoken unto you. Because you believe, now you are clean. You are justified. You are sanctified. Abide in me and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself. Meaning to say, you cannot serve God by your own power. You cannot serve Him by your own wealth, by your own might. The Bible says, not by power nor by might, but by the Spirit, saith the Lord. You cannot bear fruit of itself, except it abideth in the vine, no more can ye, except ye abide in me. You will only be fruitful if you will abide in me. Manatili sa Panginoon. Doing things according to the will of God and the power of God. I am the vine, ye are the branches. He that abideth in me and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. For without me, you can do nothing. Salvation is not by works. Kaya yung do na yan, service yan. O, bilang pumunta sa verse 6. If a man abide not in me, he is cast forth as a branch and is withered, and men gather them and cast into the fire and they are burned. What is this talking about? It's talking about your service, that you are not serving God and you will lose your, not salvation, testimony as a servant of God. And they will trodden you under their foot, under their feet, because they will not even believe that you are worthy in serving the Lord. So you, the men will gather you, and then you are cast into the fire and you are burned. Ngayon, if you're going to, I haven't had time to look at this, but those that are gathering unsaved and cast them into the lake of fire are angels, not men. We need to understand that at the same time. So this is talking about service. It's not talking about salvation. So how can you lose your salvation if what is being taught is not even salvation, but it is about service or fruit bearing? Parang ganito lang yan eh. May isang tao naghahanap ng pera sa ila, may poste, may ilaw, hinahanap niya. So, nakita siya ng kaibigan niya, "What are you doing?" "I'm looking for my money." "Have you found it?" "No, I'm still looking." Sabi ng kaibigan niya, "Where have you lost it in the first place?" "It is over there. I think I dropped it over there. But I'm looking here." "Why are you looking here?" "Because there is light here and it is dark over there. I will not be able to see it there, so I am looking here." The same thing. This is talking about fruit bearing or service, and they are saying that it's talking about losing salvation. It is as if they are looking for something where they did not even drop that something in that particular place. Kaya dapat base sa pinag-uusapan. If what is being taught about in the context is salvation, and if something there says that you're going to lose it, then it might be salvation. But when you're talking about a different subject and it says that you're going to lose it, you're going to lose that subject, not salvation. Even Soriano, when we had the debate, he said that he can prove in the Bible that we can lose our salvation. And then he gave a verse. Hindi ko na matandaan ano ba verse yung binigay niya. Yung mga sabi niya, "Mag-ingat kayo upang hindi nyo maiwala ang pinagpagalang ko sa inyo." So, ibig sabihin, una, it is as if he's saying that Paul is the one that caused them salvation. And then if they're not going to be diligent, they're going to lose it. Paul is not even talking about salvation. Paul is talking about everything that he taught them. Because these are the things that Paul has pinagpaguran or pinagpagalan for them. And then, if they're not going to be diligent, they will forget it. And when they forget it, they're going to lose it. So we have to be diligent in our studying the Word of God and serving God. So, it's not talking about salvation. It's talking about fruit bearing. And then Galatians 5:4, it does not teach that we can fall out of grace. Balik nga natin doon. Just simply looking at the verse and understanding, "Christ has become no effect unto you. Whosoever of you are justified by the law, ye are fallen from grace." Meaning to say, you're not even in grace. How can you fall from something that you're not even in it? Because you believe that you're justified by the law, therefore you're not justified by grace. So if you're not justified by grace, you're not saved in the first place. For by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. So, how can you fall from something when you are not even there? Ano nangyari sa'yo? Nahulog ako eh. Saan? Sa tower ng Ion. Nasaan ka ba? Sa Soria. Paano ka mahuhulog sa tower ng Ion eh? Nasa Soria ka. Nahulog ka sa Soria. Hindi sa Ion. Amen? So, the same thing here. So, it's not talking about falling from grace, but in the first place, these people are not even saved if they believe that they are justified by the law. But if you are justified by grace, then you cannot fall from grace. Because grace is an unmerited favor, and you cannot fall from a favor that you did not even merit in the first place. Nakanya magsabihin? So that's what the Apostle Paul is saying. Now, going into a very hard part, Hebrews 6:4-6 and Hebrews 10:26-29. This will be simplified if we, in the first place, understand who is writing and to whom is he writing. Obviously, the book is called the book of Hebrews. Amen. Therefore, the writer is writing to Hebrews, not to the Gentiles. You understand that? He's writing to the Hebrews. And Hebrews have a different set of customs, traditions, and religious understanding. They are, though saved, they are still leaning into the Old Testament way of justification as they understand it. That is what the Hebrews believe. So, when these verses were given, the Bible is telling them that if you will reject Christ, there is no other way of salvation. Because for them, they believe in many ways of salvation. Like doing the Ten Commandments, like obeying and performing the festivals, like washing their hands before they eat, like worshiping on Sabbath day, like the laws that were given unto them. So, but pastors, how about the description? That is the point. Look at the description. For it is impossible for those who were once enlightened and have tasted of the heavenly gift and were made partakers of the Holy Ghost, hanggang 6 yan, and have tasted the good word of God and the power of the word to come, if they shall fall away, to renew them again unto repentance, seeing they crucify to themselves the Son of God afresh and put him to an open shame. Very simple. A Jew who believes on the Lord Jesus Christ, is impossible to reject Jesus. And those who reject the Lord Jesus Christ, is impossible to accept Jesus. Why? Because there is no more sacrifice that is available to them, and there is no other repentance that they can apply except that they need to repent that they have rejected the Lord Jesus Christ in the first place. And once you change your mind, it is impossible to change your mind again. This will be affirmed by Hebrews chapter 10. Tignan natin. Kasi Hebrews pa rin to eh. 10:10-26. For if we sin willfully, after that we have received the knowledge of the truth, there remaineth no more sacrifice for sins, but a certain fearful looking for of judgment and fire indignation, which shall devour the adversaries. He that despised Moses' law died without mercy under two or three witnesses. Of how much more, how much sorer punishment suppose ye shall he be thought worthy who had trodden under the foot the Son of God and had counted the blood of the covenant wherewith he was sanctified an unholy thing and had done despite unto the spirit of grace. Tignan nyo ha, ipag-connect natin yung dalawa. Eto ngayon, naintindihan na nila. Balik mo sa 26 muna. If we sin willfully, after that we have received, natanggap mo, nalaman mo, naintindihan mo, yung knowledge of truth. Ano yung knowledge of truth? There is only one Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. It is not Judaism. It's not the law. It is not the festivals. It is not the dietary laws. It is not the all the covenants that were made by God to them. And still, they sin willfully. Ano yun? They rejected it. Alam mo na eh, pero hindi mo ginawa. Talking about salvation eh. Alam mo na, yun ang tanging paraan, pero, oops, i-reject ko yan. Unworthy yan. Hindi karapat-dapat yan. Balik tayo sa 6. Tinapak-tapakan mo. At inilagay mo ang Panginoon sa open shame. Why? Kasi pinipilit mo na parang i-crucify uli. Eh wala na. Isang beses lang. Kaya dito sa Hebrews chapter 10, in-emphasize yan. Balik tayo sa 10:10. Pompiang Gis. By the which will we are sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. Do not crucify the Lord afresh. Once lang yun. Yung ginawa niya sa atin. Ano naging epekto? Tignan mo ha. Sabi niya dito, inelaborate niya, 11. And every priest standeth daily. Diyan pa rin sila naniniwala. Ministering and offering oftentimes the same sacrifices which can never take away sins. But why do you still believe on the same sacrifices that can never take away sin? When the Lord Jesus Christ was crucified once for all, why do you reject it? And still believe on what the priests are doing? Nasa Torah pa rin sila. Torah. Japanese ang gumawa niyo, mga nagpakamatay yun eh. Oh, 12. But this man, referring to Jesus, after he had offered one sacrifice for sins, forever sat down on the right hand of God, signifying it was a finished work. Oh, verse 13. From henceforth expecting till his enemies be made his footstool. 14. For by one offering, he hath perfected forever them that are sanctified. Kayo naman kung ano-ano pa gusto nyong gawin. Hindi pwede. You are treading the Son of God under your feet and you are counting His blood as an unholy thing because you still believe on something rather than the only thing that can give you salvation. Yun yung simple explanation nito. Kaya lang, ang problema, kaya umihirap to, ina-apply natin sa atin, hindi naman tayo Hebrews. Hindi tayo Hebrew Christians. Hindi pareho ang ating set or customs and tradition on how we believe. But we believe the same, but in a different emphasis. Ganon. Kaya nga ang mga Jew, pag tumanggap, magpapabaptize doon sa time na yon. Because it is the proof that they believe. Parang halimbawa, ako naniniwala ako sa Judaism. Hudyo kayo, dumating ako. Naniniwala po ako sa Judaism. Ituring nyo akong Hudyo. Ay, hindi pwede. May tatayo, ano sasabihin? Magpatuli ka. Ayon. Pag nagpatuli ka, maniniwala kami na ini-embrace mo ang Judaism. Pero pag hindi ka nagpatuli, ano ka? Support. Yun yung sasagot eh. Hindi na ibig sabihin. Hindi ka tunay. Talaga mga Baptist tayo eh. Ibig sabihin, hindi ka tunay na naniniwala sa aming relihiyon at hindi ka namin pwedeng ituring na Hudyo. Nakuha mo ibig sabihin? Yun ang mindset ng mga Hudyo. Kaya ang Hudyo, pag sumampalataya, magpapabaptize kasi hanggat hindi nila ginagawa yun, hindi sila talagang sumasampalataya. Ganon din yung pinapaliwanag dito. Na pag yung knowledge of truth, nalaman mo na, wala nang willful sinning na ibig sabihin, i-reject mo pa willfully. Kasi alam mo ng truth eh. Alam mo na ito yung power to come. Alam mo na yung lasa na napakaganda. Alam mo, dumating na sa iyo yung enlightenment. But you still rejected. Wala na ibang paraan, kapatid. Yun ang sinasabi ng Hebrews. Wala na ibang paraan. Iisa lang. Kasi nasanay tayo sa Old Testament economy na maraming paraan para maligtas. Which is hindi maraming paraan. Isang paraan lang. Pananampalataya. At paggawa bilang patunay na merong kang pananampalataya. Kasi ngayon, isang specific lang eh, cross of Calvary. Pero noon, hindi. Si Abraham, inoffer niya si Isaac and he was justified. Si Noah, nag-build ng ark and he was justified. Sila, ginagawa nila yung Day of Atonement and they were justified. Nung time sa Egypt, naglagay sila ng dugo sa post at saka sa lintel and they were justified. Pwede ba sabihin nila, Panginoon, nanampalataya kami. Wala, hindi na lang ko kami maglalagay ng dugo. Hindi pwede. Yun yung patunay na sumasampalataya ka. Bakit? Kasi hindi pa namamatay ang Panginoon eh. Pero ngayon namatay na ang Panginoon, pag sumampalataya ka, ligtas ka na. Bakit? Because Jesus already finished the work of salvation. There is nothing that we can do to prove that we really believe, except our life after our profession of belief. Ganun yun. Kaya yung pinapaliwanag sa Hebrews. Kaya pag ito, if you will go and interpret Hebrews the same as other books in the New Testament or other epistles, makukulta utak mo. And you will not be able to arrive at a right conclusion because you are explaining to the Gentiles what is applicable to the Jews. That's the problem. That's why Hebrews. Amen? The book of Hebrews. Hindi siya talaga para sa atin yung ipinapaliwanag. But there are so many things that we can learn. Like for example, ito, one offering. That the new covenant is superior than the old covenant. These are the things that we can get from the book of Hebrews. But when it comes to the strict application of the religion, that is not our customs, that is not our religious tradition. And the author of Hebrews, which many says is the Apostle Paul, or some says it's not the Apostle Paul, is simply explaining to them what they need to understand when it comes to what the Lord Jesus Christ did, as with that are connected with their religious system. Because the religious system, even though it is false, kasi hindi nagpapaliwanag na maliwanag ng kaligtasan eh, all the elements of salvation are mentioned there. Kamukha ng mga type. Na, you know, first fruits is a type. Burnt offering is a type. Yung feast of tabernacle is a type. All of these are types that they have to do in order to prove that they believe. Wala na tayong type na pwedeng gawin ngayon kasi ito na yung anti-type. So all we have to do is repent and believe without actually doing anything. But if we really believe, it will result in doing good things because we are created unto good works once we got saved. Kung sila nga, wala mang Holy Spirit, ang kanilang salvation, promise lang, nakagawa ng mabuti, eh di lalo na tayo. Na nung sumampalataya tayo, nanahan na yung Holy Spirit at naligtas na talaga tayo. So that is what this is actually talking about or explaining. Mag-aalas 12 na pala. Wala pa tayo sa proper. So, ano ba ang proper thing to do? Oo. O yung pang-apat. It is not true that teaching eternal security will give the believer a license to live as he please, because eternal security will actually help us understand that we have to live circumspectly because the Holy Spirit is in our hearts and it will cause us to live a better life than before because we are now a new creature. And the fact remains the same that all things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. Even though there is a battle, the thing is this. Before you got saved, there is no battle because we only have one nature. And that is our sinful nature. But once we got saved, we have a new nature. And that new nature is battling with our old nature. Therefore, no matter what happened, there is always a struggle. Before, we can commit sin and enjoy it. But now, we may commit sin, but repent of it. Not enjoy it. That we can feel miserable whenever we do that. So there is now a restraint in what we can do. Before, when we do good, it is because we have our own selfish motive. But now we can do good for the sole purpose of glorifying God. So that's why it is not a license na mabuhay tayo ng riotous living And the most important proof is that eternal security has a twin in the Bible, and that is chastisement. If you are eternally secured, you cannot separate the doctrine of chastisement. Because if you will live in a riotous manner after getting saved, then the hands of God will always be with you, not in the form of punishment to bring you to hell, but to chastise you. And we know that Hebrews chapter 5. Kung di ako nagkakamali. 5 o 12 lang yan eh. Chapter 5, anak. Verse 12 ba? Yata. Chapter 12, 6. For whom the Lord loveth, he chasteneth. Oh, see? And scourgeth every son whom he receiveth. Oh, anak ka na nga, pero merong scourging. Merong chastising. Bakit? Because there is now a new relationship. Dating relationship, enemies with God. And when enemy, we will be brought to hell. But now the relationship is father and son. And because there is a father and son relationship, we will be disciplined. And everybody is a partaker of God's chastisement. Kaya parang ganito yan, oy, save na ako. Gagawin ko na kahit na anong gusto ko. Sabi ng Diyos, anak, tingin sa akin, kung kaya mo. Ayun. Kaya mo. Ay, hindi ha, mahirap yan. Ayusin mo. Ay, di ba? Ganun lang yun eh. Para naalala ko na naman si Jong. Nung bata pa, nanood ng Power Ranger. Talagang gustong gusto niya. Kaya niya eh. Talagang tuwan-tuwa siya eh. Eh medyo napabayaan yung katungkulan niya. Halika rito, Jong. Dapa, papaluin kita dahil hindi mo ginawa ito. Hindi mo ako mapapalo. Kaya niya? Sabi ko, bakit? Ako! Si Power Ranger! Ah, ganun ha, kako. Oh. Ah, talagang palong ano, namumutaktak. Pagkatapos, anak, sinong mas magaling? Si Power Ranger o ang daddy mo? Daddy! Kanya o, see? Ganun lang yun, kaya ganun din sa atin. Ah, Panginoon, ligtas na ako, gagawin ko na lahat ng gusto mo. Ah, sige, kung kaya mo. Ay, kung hindi mo kaya, wag. Ayan, di ba? So, may restraint. Meron tayong fear. Even though we will still stumble and we will still fall, pero that fear is a restraining factor. And that was brought about by assurance of our salvation. So what are the reasons why we cannot lose our salvation? And we will discuss this tomorrow in our Sunday school, okay? Okay, thank you very much. And shall we stand?